Japanology. Our theme is Kendo, one of Japan's martial arts. The swordsmanship is popular with people of all ages, but it's much more than a sport. Modern Kendo has its roots in the skilled swordsmanship of the samurai warrior. The spiritual side of Kendo developed over the years. Today, we'll introduce the deep and seductive world of Kendo.
Yeah! Yeah!
Yeah! Hello, I'm Peter Barragan.
Konnichiwa, I'm Mami Kikuchi.
Welcome to Weekend Japanology.
This program is coming to you on NHK World TV and Radio Japan.
And as you can probably tell from that blood-curdling scream today, our theme is Kendo.
And we have three guests in studio today. Mr. Alec Bennett from New Zealand and his two students. Mr. Bennett teaches Japanese culture at Teikyo University in Tokyo. Mm-hmm. He is also a practitioner of Kendo. He holds the sixth degree Dan, which he will explain later in the mm-hmm. program.
And you also represent New Zealand at international tournaments.
That's
don't
right.
You?
Yep, we've got the world champs coming up soon. So mm-hmm. yeah, international tournaments like that. Yep.
Right. How long have you been doing Kendo for?
Ooh, too long. 20 years. I start to feel my age now. 20 years altogether so far.
Wow.
Yep. So it's just over half my life.
Wow.
Great.
And your two students are fully attired here for doing Kendo. Perhaps you could do a brief explanation of the various gear that they have on.
Sure, it looks like something out of Star Wars, yeah. doesn't it? What we have, before I explain the armor, which is called Bogu, underneath that we have the Kendo-gi, or Keiko-gi, which is thick cotton, which provides a little bit of protection and also absorbs a lot of sweat during mm-hmm. the uh-huh. rigorous trainings.
Beautifully indigo dyed.
Mm. That's right, yep. Yeah. And of course the lower half of the body is, we have the hakama, mm-hmm. which is sort of like formal Japanese attire,
right.
Which was worn by the samurai warriors themselves, of course.
Right.
When we're sort of fighting with bamboo sticks, well, actually called shinai, which are representative of the sword.
Right.
You require this kind of protection.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually very thick and heavy, but it's also very light.
Mm-hmm.
The bamboo sword itself is made of four slats of bamboo mm-hmm. tied together at both ends with leather. This is the hilt. Mm-hmm. This is the tip of the sword.
Mm-hmm.
This string at the back is the back of the sword. Japanese swords only have one cutting edge.
Right.
So this represents the non-cutting edge and holds everything together.
Uh-huh.
And this is the cutting edge. So, this is the basic equipment collectively called Bogu that we use
armor.
In Kendo. That's right.
Okay.
Thank you. So, now let's take a look at the history of Kendo.
In the 16th century, power struggles raged among samurai warriors for about 100 years. This was a period of successive civil wars. Samurai warriors refined sophisticated techniques for attacking the target to death with a sword. Various schools of swordsmanship were developed. However, in the 17th century, the war-torn era came to a close with national unification at the hand of the Tokugawa shogunate. This ushered in an era of peace and radical social change. Among the samurai warriors who survived the turbulent period was Miyamoto Musashi, a renowned historical figure. From his teens throughout his 20s, Miyamoto Musashi fought in more than 60 duels and was never once defeated. He was inarguably the master of the sword. In the warring period, he was a presence because of his mastery of the sword. However, with stability, even the great Miyamoto lost his place in society. Miyamoto Musashi went on to write Gorin no Sho, or The Book of Five Rings, which told of the ideal path of the samurai. You will reach the state of mental purity, naturally, if you maintain an honest heart and always make efforts in study. This is the sublime way of the sword. We With peace, the samurai warriors began to pursue the art of developing themselves spiritually alongside swordsmanship. Naganuma Shiro Zaimon Kunisato developed a school of Kendo at the beginning of the Edo period, or early 18th century, which closely resembles the Kendo of today. He developed Kendo equipment, including the bamboo sword called Shinai, and the protective armor called Bogu. He also established practice methodology, which was adopted throughout Kendo. Today, Kendo is enjoyed by the young and old. It's used as part of the school curriculum and for character building.
Well, as we've just seen in the video now, the roots of Kendo go all the way back to the traditional samurai culture. But before we get into that side of it, let's basically go through the rules of Kendo as a sport, yeah?
Right, yeah, sure. Well, the rules for somebody who has never done Kendo before can be very confusing.
All right, thanks for telling us.
But just basically, a Kendo match is usually 3 to 5 minutes in duration. Mm-hmm. And the first person to score 2 points before time is up is deemed the winner. However, if the time of the match finishes and one person only has 1 point, then that person is the winner. Mm-hmm. Or it can be a draw if they have 1 point each or no points each.
Okay.
But the idea is to score 2 clean ippon, or points, before time.
And clean is the operative word.
Clean is the operative word. I'll just borrow one of the students here. There are only 4 targets in Kendo. Mm-hmm. However, there are many variations of these 4 main targets. Now, the first target is called man.
Okay.
Okay, and that is the head area, but it's a certain part of the head, and that's right at the top here. So between these strings.
Uh-huh.
Okay,
uh-huh.
At the top. If it slides down and, on the side, or it hits him on the side there, it's not considered a point. It has
so
to be.
So that's the reason
here.
You have these thick flaps on the side. It's
exactly
to protect you from missed shots,
wayward strikes.
Okay,
exactly,
yeah.
Right. Okay, so men is the first one. This is probably the most coveted point in Kendo. It's the ultimate, if you like.
Okay.
We have a kote strike as well, which is.
On the wrist.
Generally,
then.
On the right wrist. Uh-huh. Now, when we do Kendo, we usually fight from what is called chudan, which is a stance where you have the right hand forward and the left hand back. Uh-huh. So your right hand is exposed.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
So you can score a point on the right wrist as opposed to the left wrist, which is not a target generally.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Another point is do, which is can be scored either side. But not in the middle, generally on the sides here, so you're cutting right into the side of the body.
And it's got to be on the armour.
It's got to be on the armour. If you strike somebody under there, it's going to hurt, and it's not going to be counted as a point.
Seriously, I would
imagine.
Yeah,
it does. It hurts a lot, but it doesn't happen very often, okay? Mm. So it's generally, it's got to be on the target.
Okay.
Okay, if it's off slightly or underneath, mm-hmm. It will not count.
Okay.
Okay, and the last point is probably one of the most difficult, I think, because you require pinpoint accuracy. That's the thrust to the throat.
Oh, right.
Okay, and this is a little bit of a dangerous technique, as you can imagine, using a big bamboo stick and throwing it in somebody's in the throat.
Yeah.
It's actually prohibited up to high school level in Japan.
Okay, not surprising.
Okay,
right.
But
can I just see how? Oh, that's extremely thick and hard, the protector there.
That's right, it has to be. All the armour is designed especially to absorb the blows from the bamboo sword or the shinai.
Uh-huh.
So these are the 4 targets. However, just hitting these targets willy-nilly is not enough. There are certain criteria that have to be met.
Uh-huh.
And the first point that has to be kept in mind is you have to hit the target accurately with the correct part of the shinai.
Mm-hmm.
If it was up here, it would be too deep.
Uh-huh.
If it was here, it would be too shallow.
Mm. Okay.
Okay, so the area that we're striking with is this area around here, which is called the monouchi.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the monouchi has to strike the target Kote miste. Okay, has to strike the target, not the tip of the sword, or not too deep. And that goes from mang, kote, do, and ski, obviously, using the point. The reason why you can only use the monouchi to cut is, well,
I should add that this is a fake sword, it's not a real, it's not the real thing.
Okay, the most devastating cutting power comes from this part of a sword. Okay, and that's, this, even though the shape is very different, the bamboo sword is representative of a Japanese sword or katana.
Right.
So essentially when we're cutting, we're not cutting here,
right.
We're not cutting deep, we're cutting right on the most
okay.
Powerful part of the blade.
Right, okay. You use your imagination.
That's right. All right. But also another thing that has to be kept in mind when you're making the cut is, if you can imagine you're cutting with a sword, if the sword was slightly on an angle, it wouldn't be cutting, but if anything, you're going to break your blade.
Right.
So the blade has to be straight.
Okay.
Or has to be actually cutting if you put it to your skin. If it was like that, it wouldn't do anything. So with a shinai, even though it's cylindrical,
you can still tell.
You can still tell
where the string is.
That's right. So if we're striking like that, then it's not going to count. Different to, say, fencing, for example, all you have to do is touch the opponent's body with your sword. In kendo, not only do you have to cut the right target with the right part of the blade, but you have to make your cut with something called ki ken tai ichi, which is a really long, complicated word, but breaking it down, ki is your spirit, ken is the sword. Tai is your body. And ichi is all together.
Ichi.
Okay.
So it's got to be unified. Okay, so all of these things have to be together. So when you make a cut, okay, when we say ki ken tai ichi, it means your ki, your body, and your sword, and everything has to be together. So, mang, it's all.
Okay, all over the place.
All over the place.
Yeah.
So we bring that all together. Our ki is represented through shouting the target that you're striking. And the sword and the body coming together as one. Mm-hmm. So it would be bam, or kote, or do. Everything comes together. So this ki ken tai ichi is very important.
Okay.
Another thing which is required to make a point is after you've made the strike, and you've cut, say, man with ki ken tai ichi, striking, making the attack, making the cut is just 50%. After that, you have to run through and show what is called zanshin.
Zanshin
is leftover heart. And this comes directly from actual combat experience.
This is where it relates to the samurai, I think.
That's right. So, for example, in fencing, if you make a point, the sword touches your opponent's body and a light comes on, then it's a point. In kendo, that is 50% of the process. What you do after you make the cut, in other words, zanshin is showing continued mental and physical alertness, always ready in case your opponent makes an attack against you. Okay, whether it's a point or not, it's irrelevant. It's that kind of combat mindset, which is very...
It's a constant combat awareness, basically.
Exactly. And when you have all of these things coming together, the referee will put up their flag and judge it as a yuko datotsu, or a valid strike, or 1 point. Or if one of these is missing, for example, there's no kiken taichi, or there's no zanshin, or it's slightly off target, then it will not be counted as a point.
Oh, I see. So if you think you've made a really good hit, but the referee doesn't, and you're expecting the action to stop and it doesn't, and then you kind of let your attention waver for a minute, the chances are your opponent's going to get one on you.
That's right, exactly.
Okay.
And that's why in kendo, for example, in other sports, when you score a goal or you score a point, everybody's running around going, the greatest. But in kendo, if you have zanshin, you cannot do that. So in kendo, we never throw up our arms and show emotion because we're always ready for combat.
I've never seen that.
Okay, that's really important in kendo. It's one of the most important aspects of it, in fact.
It's not just a game.
No, it's not. It's very serious.
Yeah. Shall we have a look
at
some of the things you've just explained actually in practice with the two students?
Well, I'll get the two students to do the four basic techniques, men, kote, do, and tsuki.
Okay.
We'll start off with men uchi. Ja, onegai shimasu.
Yeah!
So as we've just seen, we start off shouting. There's a lot of shouting in kendo. This is called kiai, and what this kiai does is it sort of bolsters your own spirit. It sort of makes your opponent afraid, and it brings everything together, brings your whole body and mind together. And you make the nice clean cut by taking one step forward. That distance is called one step, one sword. So just by taking one step, you can lunge in and make an attack. Let's have a look at kote. Ja, onegai shimasu.
Yes.
Okay, and as you see, even though he didn't run through, he bounced off him, and he's still showing Zanshin, ready to go. Okay, all the time. Okay, so next we'll show do, okay, which is the body area. Okay, ja do uchi onegai shimasu.
Okay, you follow it through and turn round.
That's right, goes down, cuts down, follows through, and then turns round ready for action again. Okay, so the Zanshin is always there. And the last technique is the tsuki. It's probably one of the most dangerous techniques in kendo because you're actually thrusting forward into the throat. Now, this requires great skill, and children are never taught how to do this. It's something you develop when you're a high school student or above. So, tsuki onegai shimasu.
Wow.
Okay. So as you can see, there's a lot of force behind that.
Right. I mean, you're supposed to put that much force in, are you?
Yes. For it to be counted as a point. The reason that force is there is because of the ki, ken, tai, ichi.
Okay.
It's all coming together.
It must be a great shock when you got the tsuki.
It's pretty intimidating.
Surprisingly, not really. If you're fighting somebody good, it's sort of your borgu, or your armor absorbs it, and you naturally go back, so sort of taking the shock. If it misses and goes off the side, sometimes it can be a little bit painful, but generally it's not too bad. Okay, as I mentioned, the shikake waza, there's also a set or a group called oji waza, and there are, that is, you're coaxing your opponent into making an attack, whatever that might be, and as soon as they make that attack, you counter-attack. So many, many different variations and kinds of oji waza, but one of the easiest ones to understand, because some of them are very subtle, as you can imagine, one of the clearest ones is kaishi waza. In kaishi waza, there are different targets that you can attack, but the most common one is coax your opponent into striking your man, okay, and blocking that and then returning with a strike to the door. Okay, that's called men kaishi do. Okay. Anyway, let's have a look at the demonstration of men kaishi do onegai shimasu.
Ooh, impressive.
Okay, so as you can see, he brought his opponent to strike man, he received it, then returned it, and then followed through and showed Zanshin. So, so it's a very clear technique.
Okay. Well, we're going to take a look at our next video now, and we're going to see how difficult this is, even for the experts.
Aipomen!
Kendo teaches the importance of improving mental strength by overcoming personal weak points, rather than focusing on victory or defeat. Naoki Eiga is one of the top-class Kenshi. He has participated in the World Kendo Championship for 4 successive years as Japan's representative. Eiga struggled on his journey to attain the highest rank, especially when it came to making the perfect strike. The All Japan Kendo Championship in 1999 was a pivotal moment for Eiga. In the semifinal, he faced Masahiro Miyazaki, who had reached the position of Japan's top Kenshi for a total of 5 times. Eiga's strategy was to beat Miyazaki by enticing him to use his favorite men technique, to which he'd respond with Kaeshi Waza. For 3 minutes of the tournament, the scene had played out exactly as Eiga had anticipated. But...
Ippon for Miyazaki!
Eiga thought that he'd responded with a do to the men that Miyazaki had made. However, the call was indeed Ippon for Miyazaki. Eiga could hardly believe his ears. The judges didn't recognize Eiga's do. Instead, they saw Miyazaki's men as the ippon, which he made in the brief moment when Eiga was about to move forward. Eiga realized that the reason for the outcome was that he'd been too focused on victory and defeat.
Miyazaki's mind was free of intent. He put his whole body and soul in the instant that he made his men. My do came from a thought-out plan. It's all about the state of mind.
After his defeat, Eiga worked on mental training to overcome his desire to win. He did so every day, alone at the dojo. What he aimed to achieve was a pure or unconscious technique, totally free of desire. One year later, Eiga met Miyazaki again at the final of the All Japan Kendo Championship.
Red for Miyazaki and white for Eiga.
The close contest went into extension for 8 minutes. That was the instant when the opponent attacked with his favorite men. Seamlessly, Eiga moved back his left foot and made a kote strike. The judges named Eiga the winner for his seamless kote.
Naoki Eiga achieved his first victory in the All Japan Kendo Championship.
You'll never make the perfect strike when you're aware of it. You achieve it intuitively. The technique comes an instant before you're aware of it. And everyone wants this supreme technique.
What Naoki Eiga learned was that to win over an opponent means to win over oneself. He says that in the future, he hopes to hand down the spirit of Kendo to children.
That was really fascinating. It was a very good illustration of what you were talking about a moment ago. The mental side of it really is probably as important as the physical side.
It becomes increasingly so. Of course, when you're young, you're fast and you're strong and you're I guess you've got good reflexes and so on. So you can get away with all sorts of acrobatic techniques when you're when you're high school or university. But as you get older, you start losing your physical edge, as human beings do. And that's when you start to respect and understand the spiritual and the mental aspects more. And that's when kendo really starts getting interesting, in fact.
Now, we have a chart here for what are called the shikai in Japanese.
Right, yeah.
Or four sicknesses of the heart.
And this basically means that when you're faced with an opponent, maybe your opponent does something a little bit strange, does some kind of strange movement. If you get surprised, oh, what's going on there? That means that there's an opening in your mental armor called a ski. Opening, right? And so if there's an opening there, that means that you are vulnerable to being struck. Or say you go up against an opponent who is very famous as a strong kendoka, and you think, oh, geez, he's scary. Then again, it's, without even starting the match, that fear
is a big disadvantage.
Well, it's another an opening in your
chink in your armor.
Chink in your armor, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
Again, doubt. You're up against an opponent. And you think, what's he doing? Maybe I should. Maybe if I did that, he might hit me in the kote. Well, doubting yourself. Again, that means it stops you going forward and making a fully committed attack. And hesitation. What was I supposed to do then? Again. So all of these kind of what they call the four weaknesses of the heart, these are what stop you progressing in kendo. They stop you from striking a valid point, okay? Or they result in you actually being struck instead.
Right.
So throughout your kendo training, you're always learning, trying hard to expel these weaknesses. To never be afraid, never doubt, never hesitate, never be surprised, so that regardless of who you come up against in a match or training or in any situation, you are able to overcome that and demonstrate your true ability. Even in everyday life, you are confronted with all sorts of situations. Maybe your girlfriend leaves you, or you know, any kind of situation. You have developed through kendo the mental and the emotional stability to be able to deal with these things in everyday
life.
Fear
and hesitation are the things that we all experience all the time.
I'm sure. The first and the last opponent is yourself.
Exactly. At the end of the day, that's precisely what the way of kendo is supposed to be, and that's why they say that kendo is a way of developing the self. It's exactly through this kind of process that you are able to develop not only as a kendoka, but also as a human being. And the beauty of it is that it's something that continues right the way through your entire life, even to your 70s or 80s or 90s.
If you live that long,
Yeah, exactly.
We introduced you as the holder of 6-degree dan. Can you explain the dan system,
the
ranking
system?
The
dan system in kendo. Dan system has changed recently. It used to be up to 10th dan, but now it's up to 8th dan. So 8th dan technically is as high as you can go in kendo. To pass 8th dan is just, it's incredibly difficult. You start, although it's not on the chart, you have underneath the dan grades, which are essentially like in judo or karate, you have belts, right?
A black belt.
A black belt. So your first dan would be your first black belt.
Right.
You have the higher grades after that. In addition to dans, when you get up to the 6th dan level, there are also things called shogo, or it's difficult to translate, but kind of teaching certificates. If you think of dan grades as an indication of your technical ability, the shogo are representative of your understanding of the philosophy of kendo and its application to your everyday life, and also your teaching ability. So they're like teaching certificates. So the highest that you can go in kendo now is to be 8th dan hanshi. And there's not many of those around, as you can imagine. It's like the top of the top.
Now, you're a renshi, right?
That's
in addition
right.
to being a 6th dan.
Yes.
What did you have to do to get that?
After I received my sixth dan, after passing the examination, I had to write, I think it was about a year later, a thesis about Kendo and its application in everyday life, and I submitted that to the Federation and they passed it, and therefore I received my Renshi.
And then once you get beyond that, then it's the very rarefied air of the Hanshi, is the sort of final holy grail, as it were.
Well, it is really, it's like Grand Master status.
Okay. Yeah. And on our next video, we're going to take a look at what that entails.
The test for promotion to the highest ranking 8th Dan is the most difficult. Indeed, only 500 people hold the rank. Only 1 out of 5,000 Kenshi can reach it. Application rules are stringent too. The applicant must be 46 years old or older, and 10 years must have elapsed since he or she was promoted to the 7th Dan. The idea behind this is that the 8th Dan holder will be in a state of maturity. First, there are 2 rounds of technical tests to be passed. All the judges are 8th Dan Hanshi. They look for how many perfect strikes the Kenshi makes during a designated length of time. A strike is judged to be perfect when a Kenshi's body and mind are in perfect balance. It's not all about victory or defeat. After passing the technical tests, a Kenshi takes a theoretical exam. This is an actual problem. Kendo teaches that the sword is the soul. Write down your thoughts on this idea and give examples. Judges use this exam to evaluate the Kenshi's mental preparedness toward Kendo. Many of the applicants are senior citizens. In 1 year, 100 of the 700 applicants were over 70 years of age. Mochida Moriji is one man that all Kenshi hold in high esteem. He was one of the very few 10th Dan Hanshi. He was also dubbed the swordsman sage of the 20th century. He practiced at the dojo until his death at the age of 89. He left these words on the quintessence of Kendo. It took me 50 years to learn the basics of Kendo. It wasn't until I turned 50 that my real training started. I was then ready to practice Kendo with all my spirit. When I turned 60, I compensated for the decline in the strength of my lower back and legs by using more of my spirit. When I turned 70, my body power declined on the whole. That's when I kept my spirit still. By doing so, I was able to see the reflection of my opponent's heart. The teachings of Mochida Moriji continue to have influence on many people who are practicing Kendo for pleasure and in the pursuit of rank.
He was amazing, wasn't he?
Unreal.
So effortless, wasn't it?
Well, he's a legend. He was a 10th Dan sensei. We don't have 10th Dans anymore.
Right. Yeah.
He was 10th Dan, so to be awarded 10th Dan, it was only a very, very small handful of people throughout history that had ever achieved that rank. And the person he was fighting, he looked like a child, really, didn't he?
Sort of like an amateur, yeah. Yeah,
but he's a very staunch individual himself.
Oh, really?
Obviously a champion, and but just to go up against somebody like Mochida Sensei, again, he looks like an amateur, but it's an indication of the amazing skill and mental power that Mochida Sensei had, and that came through decades of hard, harsh training, where he got to the stage where even there was no real speed or strength as such in his techniques, but there was no wasted movement. And if you can imagine, a great tennis player would stand in the middle of the court and hit the ball from one side to the other while the other person's running back and forth.
Right,
it's exactly like that because he's in total control. He's in total control of himself and he's in total control of his opponent. He can read what he's doing before he even does it. And that's why it looks so effortless.
But his body looks so relaxed.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah. Legs just flow.
He's at one with his kendo.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's...
The level of concentration was just incredible.
Now, I've never gone against a tenth dan before, but I have fought a number of ninth dans and eighth dan senseis.
Oh, there are still some ninth dans around,
yes, from
there?
The old system. Very few now. But when you're fighting these usually very elderly gentlemen by this stage, 60, 70, 80 years old, I mean, to get eighth dan, you have to be late 40s, early 50s, and that's taking it very quickly.
Right.
So usually 50s to 60s, and so that some of these old sensei that are very highly ranked, I mean, obviously they've been doing it for so long, you go up against them, even though compared to me they don't have my speed or my physical strength, when you stand up against them, suddenly you're overpowered. It's difficult for a Western to explain rationally, but it's like ki or power is pushing you back. When you stand up against them, you feel yourself being pushed back, and you feel your energy being sucked out of you. It's like something out of Star Wars again, like using the Force. But when you go up against these ogres, you can see them even coming in to hit you, but you're paralyzed.
So it's those four weaknesses coming back to haunt you again.
Yeah, they just draw them out of you. Okay, and it's through training like this every day with these kind of people that you are able to overcome it eventually. But it's very difficult to explain unless you're out there doing it, how this special power, this aura that seems to come out of these great sensei. It really is quite remarkable. And for me, coming from New Zealand, I don't know of any sports where people can actively participate into their 70s and 80s and still beat young athletes. But kendo is exactly
right. I mean, in most sports, I mean, by the time you hit your late 30s, you're pretty much getting towards the end of your career, aren't
you? Exactly. Kendo, of course, the tournament element, the shiai or the match, is a very important part of your training. But when you reach your 30s or your 40s or your 50s, you're not competing like you were at high school or university, college level anymore. However, you find something else in kendo that keeps you going. You can see the depth of it, and then you, as was mentioned in the video of the tenth dan sensei we just had, as your physical ability weakens, your mental ability strengthens, and it counters it. And if anything, that's the strongest side. And that's, you start noticing, I'm starting to notice that about now at 36. I can see it, I can sense it, I can feel it.
Practicing 20
years. Well, I'm fighting young university students every day, and if I was to try and keep up with them on a physical level, they would beat me hands down because they're so much younger and faster. But I have to find ways to use my experience and more mature spiritual power. I'm trying to think of an appropriate term in English, but
I know what you mean. Yeah,
yeah.
Which again is a very good analogy for everyday life as well.
Exactly, exactly that. And when you fight people who've been doing kendo for a number of years, as soon as you face them and you're facing off with them, through the touch of the shinai and through looking at their eyes and watching their movements, you can almost tell what kind of person they are. You can tell what they're afraid of or what their strong points are. So it's a form of communication, if you like, and you're communicating with each other, teaching each other about yourself. You're learning about the other person and you're also learning about yourself at the same time, and vice versa. So looking at your opponent, when you reach a certain level of maturity in life and in your kendo, maybe in your 30s and 40s, when most people have stopped competing, for example, in other sports, you start seeing your opponent not as somebody you have to defeat in a match situation, but almost as a mirror of yourself. And through looking, you're looking at your opponent, you're looking at yourself, and you're learning about yourself. And that's when kendo becomes very, very interesting, and not just a sport. or a physical activity, it takes on more depth and more meaning. And I'm just starting to sort of sense that right now.
Well, let's take a very quick break now. We're going to go and have some music. Getting back to kendo for a moment. How widespread is it around the world now? How many countries take part in kendo?
Well, as far as affiliates to the International Kendo Federation, not exactly sure at the moment, maybe about 45, 46 countries.
Oh, that's quite a lot.
And non-affiliates, you're looking at up to 100 even. I mean, it's all around the world. As far as numbers are concerned, compared to karate or judo, I think the actual kendo population is much smaller, but it is growing. The big countries outside of Japan are Korea. Also in Europe, it's quite popular, in particular France. And of course, where there are Japanese communities in America, Canada, South America. So it's all around the world.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for being with us in the studio today. It's been really interesting.
Well, thank you very much for asking me.
Thank you so much.
If you'd like to contact us, as always, you can do through NHK's website at www.nhk.or.jp/English.
Please email us. We look forward to hearing from you.
And we'll see you again next week. Bye-bye.
Kokinenyo.